morning. Before we begin, I would like to acknowledge that we meet and learn from each other today on country. I'm actually back at the State Library of New South Wales, so I'm coming to you from Gadigal land. And this comparatively young library sits on one of the world's great ancient libraries, a rich repository of oral tradition. And I pay my sincere respects to elders past, present and emerging, and I extend that respect to any Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander peoples who are with us here this morning for this, the first scholar talk of the 2021 season. So for those of you who don't know me, my name is Rachel Franks. I'm the coordinator of scholarship here at the library. And this series of scholar talks is one of the great treats of my job, curating this program and bringing all sorts of great research based on our collections to people here at the library and still at home. So I thought 2020 would be the end of my television career at the library, but we've had so much great feedback that people are able to access these talks live as they are being delivered and then later on through the library's website, that we are looking at this as a bit of a hybrid event today. So we have a few people here in the auditorium. Special welcome to you. And we have quite a large crowd joining us online. So thank you also for coming. If you have any questions of our speaker today, if you're online, just use the chat feature in Zoom. And I will ask those questions of Louise at the end of her talk. And if you are here in real life, just call out your question quite loudly, and then I will repeat that question so that people who aren't here can hear what it is that you've had to say. So normally our scholar talks are delivered by the library's fellows, but what people often forget is that we actually have some world-leading expertise here at the library on staff, which is very exciting. So today is one of those special days where I actually get to introduce one of my colleagues, and I'm introducing Louise Anamart, who is the Director of Library and Information Services here at the library, and also the Dixon Librarian. Now, some of you may know Louise through this incredibly handsome book, Natural Curiosity, which I've discovered is still available here at the library shop. And Louise is going to be talking about some of her research here on the library's collections, focusing today on the unseen art of the First Fleet. Thanks very much. Thanks.
Thank you, Rachel, and welcome to everyone online and on site. Now, I've just possibly to Rachel's chagrin, let her know that I've decided to give you the long version of this lecture. So it's quite packed with information. So I'm going to whiz through it and allow time, still hopefully allow quick time for questions at the end. So what we're focusing on today is a collection of 745 natural history watercolours. I'll give you the... This worked when we tested it 5 minutes ago. There we go. We don't need that one. A large collection of 745 natural history watercolours that came to light in 2011 after 170 years residing in a private aristocratic library, the library of the now 19th Earl of Derby, and it was acquired by the State Library. Now, that collection was housed here in Knowsley Hall in Liverpool in England. I have been to the outside of that hall. I haven't been inside. It's now, you can see the couple on the other side of the lake. It's now better known as a wedding venue. The library is at the Derby family seat, so at Knowsley Hall. And bits of it have been sold off over the years, including the collection that we're going to talk about today. So this is the 13th Earl of Derby. he had the drawings, or the drawings had been bound more or less by theme or by subject into six volumes. And while they represent really just the tiniest fraction of the Derby Library holdings, they're of the greatest significance to our understanding of the first decade or so of European colonization in Australia. And the drawings have been created by a number of artists, almost all of whom remain unknown. And they were compiled into a collection in the 1790s by a now forgotten, but then widely known and acclaimed natural historian called Alma Burke Lambert. And you can see him here. Although they'd rarely been seen since the 1940s, three of the volumes that this library acquired were really well known from the literature. These volumes contained well-documented copies of drawings from the iconic Watling collection, which we'll talk about a little bit later. And that collection was compiled in Sydney Cove by the First Fleet Surgeon, Surgeon General John White. And White then had lent them to Lambert in 1797, after White had returned to England. Lambert had copies made of White's collection of drawings at this time, so 97 into 98, and it's these copies that form the first three volumes of the Derby collection. Since 1902 then, White's Watling collection has been housed in the Natural History Museum collection in London. The existence then of the remaining three Derby volumes appear completely unrecorded and undocumented before 1842, when Edward Stanley Smith, the 13th Earl of Derby, acquired them from Lambert's estate after Lambert had died. How, when, and where Lambert acquired them is still unknown. I do have some theories, but I can't prove anything at this stage, but we'll just talk through the process. So from the beginning, what we thought we had was what we thought we acquired with this collection was a single collection with a single story. It actually turned out to be several collections containing many stories. So many of the drawings are bold and striking examples of Australian birds. That went a bit fast. Ants, fish. A few of mammals, just a very few. And a single landscape scene. And this one, it took me a while to work out what this is, but this is actually Norfolk Island. There is a whole story around this particular image, but I don't actually have time to tell you that particular story today. So why there were so many drawings recorded at this time was because the natural world that the British found in Australia was so strange and wondrous and puzzling. And it was all so new that they seemed that the natural world here seemed to be almost the stuff of fairy tales. And as responses to those bewildering and captivating first encounters, drawings such as these are like a time capsule that connect us with the unique pre-European natural environment in the Sydney Basin. Virtually unexamined since acquired by the 13th Earl of Derby in 1842, they're also, because of that, startlingly fresh. The colours are very bright and they're in very good condition. So the public emergence of these six volumes of Derby, six Derby volumes, has been a little bit like finding that lost piece of a jigsaw at the back of the sofa. We're able now to compare and consider these volumes alongside others from the same period that are held, some still held privately, or by many different collecting institutions in different countries. And we've found that they're intimately interconnected. So what the library acquired with this collection is a large piece of a much bigger 200-year-old natural history puzzle that tells us so much about the value and the uses of drawings, and that have made us look again at what we thought we knew, to look again at all the known collections from the first dozen or so years of the colony alongside each other, collections that tell us so much about the fascination that Britain and Europe felt for the natural world that they found in Australia, and about responses to the new and the unfamiliar, to a world in which nature was reversed. Of course, there were many people who hated every minute of being in New South Wales. I'm going the wrong way. But there were enough who were captivated and delighted by the contrasts, and even boasting about them in their letters home. Some wrote that they'd arrived at the most beautiful place, a Lieutenant of the Marines, Ralph Clark, or of the variety of romantic views, the sweet confusion of the careless hand of nature, Surgeon George Worgan. For the young Elizabeth MacArthur, who arrived with the Second Fleet in 1790, she wrote, "Everything was new. Every bird, every insect, flower, all was novelty and was noticed with an eager degree of curiosity," which of course is all just the polite 18th century way of going, "Whoa, what the?" So it's easy to forget, especially with their high market values today, that drawings like these were not about art. They were about fascination, acquisitiveness, science, and the quest for knowledge. Not only a record of what they found, with the passage of time, the drawings are also a benchmark for what has been achieved and lost. They're scrutinized today for evidence of environmental change, lost species and habitats, for loss of biodiversity, and for information about Indigenous language and the loss of a traditional culture. A lot of artists made attempts to transcribe the Indigenous name for what they were drawing on their drawings. And so they're about the process by which Australia emerged really into world consciousness. Our usual picture of the convict colony founded in January 1788 at Sydney Cove focuses rightly on extremes of hardship, isolation and punishment, the gradual dispossession of Indigenous cultures, and on the environmental and psychological impacts of colonisation. The stories that we tell are often of crimes and misdemeanours and slow conquering of a landscape that at the time was considered both alien and inferior. Today, the impression remains of a nation built on near starvation, suffering, floggings and hangings, and a sense of utter futility. But could our ideas about the First Fleet have become just a little lazy? And what could the sudden emergence of a large, previously unknown collection of natural history drawings from New South Wales add to our understanding of those early years of the colony? The literature devoted to the art of Australia's First Fleet is thick on the ground, and it's really rare for new material to surface to add to that canon of existing drawings. But this is exactly what occurred when the Derby collection volumes appeared. And of course, there is truth in those enduring stories of extreme hardship and abandonment. Life in the colony was without question an immensely difficult, bewildering, and alienating experience. The climate was harsh and unfamiliar. The environment was challenging and unpredictable. There were dire food shortages and rationing, and a crippling sense of isolation, of having been dumped, abandoned, and forgotten. And that not only for the convicts. The Reverend Richard Johnson described the experience as being like having been buried alive. But there were also people who found the time and the space to explore and observe and to draw and record the strange new world that they found in New South Wales. And drawing started early in the colony. First Fleet entering the heads. On the 11th of February, 1788, so just 2 weeks after the arrival of the fleet of convict ships, Surgeon Arthur Bode-Smythe records drawing this grass tree. So he didn't date this drawing, but he does record in his journal that he drew it on this day. So the various sets and collections of watercolour drawings from the 1790s still present as a fairly vexed tangle, I suppose, of problems. drawings privately held or held in collecting institutions in the United Kingdom, New Zealand and Australia, even Germany. I found some that tie into this. Only some very, very few of the drawings are signed and can therefore be formally ascribed to a small number of either naval or convict artists or ship surgeons. Attributions then are uncertain. And adding to the confusion is the fact that the strong demand for images of new species amongst mainly gentlemen, sometimes women, amateurs of science in Britain, meant that copying was rife in England, which is perhaps not surprising, but we found also in New South Wales, and possibly also en route back to England, shared by officers, or even it's been thought copied by company artists in India during stopovers. So because this is all so difficult to disentangle, art historians and curators have, for convenience, assigned comparable works into a couple of broad stylistic and temporal groupings. So the Port Jackson painter, for instance, and the Sydney Bird painter. Though each of these names implies a single artist's hand at work, the Port Jackson painter probably refers to at least six, possibly as many as eight different artists. The Sydney Bird painter attribution refers to at least two people, one superior artist and one far less talented. And then to complicate things even more, the early history and the provenance of the drawings has, for almost every collection, in fact, become obscured. And some of these related collections have been held by cultural institutions for decades, for over a century, but the connections between them have largely gone unnoticed. We know so much about the background and context of many of the drawings in the Derby volumes because they were compiled by Derby's friend Lambert, who was such a prolific and enthusiastic letter writer, to his close friend James Edward Smith, who was the founder in 1788 of the Linnaean Society. And Lambert's volumes of letters to Smith, they're now held in the Linnaean collection, the Linnaean Library collection in London, and they really reveal his passionate enthusiasm for natural history. His letters, I hope you can see it, but this is just a snapshot that I took when I was there rather than a proper digital image. His letters are full of underlinings and multiple exclamation marks, the more excited he gets about what he has in front of him. So his letters are, in a way, a template for the behaviour of a remarkably dedicated network of people. We think we're very networked today. We are, but so were they. They're sort of, the letters are like a roll call of the men and occasionally women throughout England and across the world, who were almost single-mindedly devoted to the pursuit of natural history, name after name after name of the famous, the well-connected, the well-travelled or well-read appear on page after page of Lambert's letters. And almost every acquisition of drawings or specimens, every collection, every collector Lambert met, every collection he acquired was quickly written up in a letter and reported to Smith. His enthusiasm and his excitement, his sheer delight reflected in these multiple underlinings and rows of exclamation marks. So his letters are full of the pleasure of the chase, if you like, reporting on collections he bought or unexpectedly received from friends and associates around the world. And his letters convey such a complete sense of the man, of his activity, his passions and motivations. And there's a wonderful letter in the Linnaean Library from his wife to a friend where she writes that you can't actually walk down the hallway anymore, let alone get into the library, because the whole house is filled with boxes that have just been delivered from a ship returning from overseas. So her letters are quite lovely. They're far less of her letters, but they're quite lovely, the way she really indulged his passions. So you can see that he's both keenly acquisitive and enormously generous. He shares and exchanges specimens and plant cuttings. He lends books and drawings, and he makes his library and his collections available to anyone who's interested. And so with his collection, a few story threads start to emerge from Lambert and his letters, from his collections and the related collections around the world. And one of the themes, one of the central parts of this story of drawing and of art practice in the colony has become copying. So copying as a valid way of circulating drawings, as a way of responding to the fascination of the new, of feeding the appetite of people like Lambert, Darby and Smith, like Sir Joseph Banks and their extensive like-minded networks to possess their own drawings, and to assist their publishing ambitions and to fill in gaps in their knowledge. Because we now have the Darby collection, we've been able to compare and consider Lambert's drawings, the Darby collection drawings, of Australian subjects from his collection alongside other collections from the same period, and it's shown them to be intimately interconnected. So when I returned to Sydney from viewing the Darby volumes, the first thing that I did then was to try and to cross-walk all the known collections to each other. So to help determine a genealogy or a primacy of the drawing. So I pulled the images or the actual collections, various collection sets of around 2,000 known drawings from that first decade of colonization, and cross-walked them. And so quite the extent of copying that took place in London and in Sydney Cove hadn't been fully appreciated, in particular, the extent to which artists in New South Wales were working together or in reference to each other. And it quickly became apparent that the same images appear again and again, reused by different artists and now part of different collections in different institutions and countries. So I looked at, among others, Surgeon John White's iconic Watling collection that we've mentioned before, now in London's Natural History Museum, the collection of drawings by Midshipman George Raper, who arrived with the First Fleet. They are also held in the Natural History Museum in London. Another set of drawings by Raper in the Alexander Turnbull Library in New Zealand. Collections at the National Library of Australia, including their Juicy collection, I like to say now previously attributed to George Raper. I don't believe they are, but I can't name the artist who did create them. And then drawings identified for the first time and now attributed for the first time to William Dawes, the astronomer, held here in the State Library of New South Wales. And we've never drawn the connection back to William Dawes before. Artists used by Governor Arthur Phillip, including his midshipman Henry Brewer, and drawings by Franz Bauer, the brother of the more famous Ferdinand, who circumnavigated Australia with Matthew Flinders, and whose New South Wales drawings are held in the library of the University of Göttingen in Germany. So this image shows you each of the images moving across represents a different, the same drawing from a different collection. So I've just pulled out a few, and similarly with the plants. So the common practice of exchanging drawings and making copies is at the core of the confusion and the uncertainty that surrounds unsigned, undated drawings relating to the early years of the colony, such as those compiled by Lambert and later acquired by Darby. Which set of drawings might be the originals is unknown and perhaps no longer actually knowable. The quality and the style of the known sets of New South Wales drawings is variable. There are clues to a possible genealogy of drawings which make and which image might be considered to be the source for the others. The lack of provenance and the absence of mostly of signatures or dates mean you need to look for other clues to understand a possible genealogy of the drawings. And one of those clues is when you find pentimenti, so changes or adjustments made in a drawing that often indicate primacy. So an artist creating a work might reposition the subject of a drawing either to improve or correct it. And these changes aren't always evident, but as this drawing of the masked lapwing shows, time will often tell. So the lead in the white paint that you can see underneath the beak, the white paint was used to obscure a correction in the drawing, but over time that's discolored to black, revealing the alteration quite clearly to the naked eye. And so these changes and corrections are not usually evident in subsequent copies. Detail is another thing we look for. Usually more detail is included in the original work, and then a little like Chinese whispers, I suppose, some of the details lost or altered each time a drawing is copied. Now, copying is a fairly loaded word in the art world these days, and copying in the context of colonial drawings didn't mean creating identical drawings, and it didn't mean forgeries. Copying meant there was a strong correlation, a conformity between some or all of the elements in a drawing. Drawings might easily be compositionally different, but still be copies in this sense. So this one shows feather detail in the top right-hand corner. And then in the subsequent copies, that feather detail disappears. A copyist might also break down the elements of an image and create several drawings to reflect the various elements in the original, or the reverse. Several smaller drawings might be copied and combined into a single work, and copies might incorporate all elements of a drawing or select only some components. So in this one, you can see the bird on the lower left has been singled out and copied subsequently, and then the bird on the lower right has been singled out and copied. Artists might repeat elements of each other's drawings, eliminate or substitute components. Detail might be lost in copies. Backgrounds might disappear or reappear, elaborate and embellished. Sometimes, though, even the smallest omission can be glaring, important, and at times inexplicable. This wattle bird has been drawn accurately with two wattles on each side of its head, one on each side of its head by the Sydney bird painter. Other versions seemingly replicate it perfectly, but for one critical detail, the omission of a wattle. So that's the detail of the what I believe is the original drawing. And then the subsequent copies are missing one of the wattles, which is why I think the top one is the original and the bottom two are copies. It's just so difficult to reconcile the possibility that the correct drawing could be anything other than the original. And this also suggests that artists were working together or in reference to each other, and suggests the possibility that they were sharing drawings and copying each other's work in little de facto drawing schools. But who were the artists? And we still can't put names to drawings in many, many cases. But we do know that the artists in the colony fell broadly into three categories. So there were convict artists, including obvious professional artists such as Thomas Watling, who worked for Surgeon John White. As a convicted forger, Watling really could have expected to have received the death sentence, but he was spared because of his aptitude for drawing, which was a recognised need in the colony. Embittered and professing his innocence, there were certainly worse outcomes for a convict artist than being assigned to a colonial master and patron such as John White, and Watling's artistic ability certainly spared him much of the hardships and the misfortune of, for example, hard labour. And we know so much about his art output, far more than most from that period, because against all explicit directives, he signed his drawings, something convicts were not meant to do. And in signing them, he angered John White, but he claimed them forever as his own. And so identifying his artistic legacy is easy. It's beyond question. He also has quite a distinctive style. And these are two of his signed drawings. The quality of the drawings by convict artists, of course, is variable. Some, such as Watling and another convict artist, John Doody, who was patronised by Captain William Patterson of the New South Wales Corps, are very well executed. Others, likely by convicts, are not. And still others show the style traits of allied trades or professions, such as the more decorative techniques of ceramics painting, which are typically characterized by more dispersed arrangements of flowers and leaves and hint at previous occupations of convict artists, and also suggest that some of our unnamed artists could in fact have been women. Surgeons were often amateur artists with an interest in recording the medicinal properties of plants, as we've seen with surgeon Arthur Both Smythe, his drawing of the grass tree, which he hoped to use in treating pulmonary disorders. There it is again. And drawing was also part of a suite of compulsory skills required for progression through the ranks of the Royal Navy. So naval art training was certainly basic in comparison with, for example, training received as if you were at the Royal Academy of Arts, for instance. So copying the work of others to learn and improve was part of a long tradition of art training, even at the Academy, especially at the Academy, which mostly began with copying. And the purpose was precisely to practice, refine, and perfect technical conventions and methods. Copying was a bread and butter skill in the art world more generally. What the Royal Navy needed, though, from its officers was something quite specific, and a style of sorts emerged to meet naval requirements. Naval drawings often feature these very precise frame lines, usually filled in with beige or pink watercolour, including inside these heavy black lines. So this is by William Bradley. These are George Raper's drawings, another naval artist. He had this gorgeous, sinuous sort of way of drawing birds and plants. It's quite distinctive, but he also helped us by signing his drawings. Naval drawings often include scales of feet. You can see the scale there. Yet the drawings with naval origins are perhaps easier to recognise by omission, by what was seemingly not taught rather than what was. So life drawing, for example, seems not to have been a focus in the curriculum of the Royal Navy, and those officers who did venture into this area generally show little skill or aptitude for it. And there's also little evidence that naval artists learned and honed the technical conventions of representing perspective or scale, for instance. The Navy needed something quite precise. They needed people who could draw coastal profiles with accuracy, draw where they had been, draw safe landing, record safe landing places for British naval ships. And natural history was also of interest. Often, though, in copying, in learning from copying in the Royal Navy, engravings and prints rather than paintings were likely to have been used to copy for practice. And you can see the effect of this in many drawings that originated in New South Wales. So shading and volume and tone in engravings are built up through the use of spaced tapering lines or by cross-hatching the been cut into a metal plate. And you can actually see the effect of that in naval drawings, which often replicate the effect of engraving lines rather than the more painterly technique of blending colour with a brush. So this is again George Raper, and you can see in that branch of the tree that he's tried to achieve volume and shape by using lines rather than by blending paint. In this work, though, that's a detail of it. In this work, though, by the Sydney bird painter, you can see this more skilled artist and the expert beautiful blending that he does in his work, suggesting the possibility that this was not the work of a naval artist. So was this a highly skilled convict artist? We don't actually know at this stage. Analysis of materials used in colonial drawings and technical knowledge of early colonial drawings goes to the heart of the many mysteries and confusion which surround the history of early colonial art in Australia. And this is an area which is surprisingly little understood. And traditional connoisseurship hasn't helped resolve the ambiguities. So one of the few remaining opportunities for further exploration and comparison has been technical observation and analysis of materials. And to illustrate this, it's worth considering two volumes of drawings more closely. The first is a volume that 100 drawings that came into the collection of the State Library of New South Wales in 1902. And the artist of this volume is the unidentified Sydney bird painter. And he was given that designation, Sydney bird painter, in the 1990s. And the provenance of these drawings, despite having been in this building since in this collection since 1902, is completely unrecorded. What we see with the Sydney bird painter is an extensive and expert use of gold leaf in his drawings. And that expert use of gold leaf, you can see it in the, you really need to see the originals, but the back feathers of the top bird and then the middle bird and the coloured feathers that come round are all, the paint is all underlaid with gold leaf. But that extensive and expert use of gold leaf has meant that it's been believed for the last three decades at least, longer, that this set of drawings have been created in India, not in New South Wales. So it's been really unexpected to come across so much inclusion of metallic leaf, gold, silver, or an alloy in a surprisingly high number of drawings of New South Wales subjects. And the extent of gold leaf is really until very recently, until we started this research with the acquisition of the Derby collection, has largely gone unnoticed and unremarked upon or explained away as non-colonial in origin. And in the absence of provenance information, it's simply been presumed that these drawings, while they might be of a New South Wales subject, they could not possibly have been created in New South Wales because of the skill required to apply gold leaf, but also because the availability of gold and the expertise to apply it so skillfully in the early colony in Australia was considered to be so unlikely as to be impossible. Yet, of course, the technique for laying down gold leaf and layering it with watercolour to imitate the appearance of gold shimmering through the paint was well known. The materials were available well before the first fleet sailed from England in 1787, and naval officers at least often supplied their own art materials. Now, new technologies such as digitization and X-ray fluorescence and micrographic photography have given us the ability to unlock new lines of investigation, look more closely at and into the drawings without harming them, and making it easier to track and cross-refer disparate images across collections and to begin to untangle them to help date them or suggest their primacy and to determine who was drawing, who was lending, and who was copying. So XRF analysis is an X-ray technique that showed that it tells you which elements have been used in drawings in watercolors. It's another, the sheeny bits on his wing. It shows you what elements, lets you look at the drawing and see what elements have been used in it. And so we found that the early New South Wales colonial drawings, it not only looked like gold, they were in fact either gold leaf of a surprisingly high purity or silver leaf or an alloy Dutch metal, which was used as a gold substitute in cheaper jewellery. The surprise is that the presence of gold and other metallic leaf is in fact quite so widespread in natural history drawings of New South Wales subjects, and it's been so skillfully applied and used to create iridescent effects in wings, eyes, heads and throats of birds or the sheen of fish. And there's also an intriguing reference in the journal kept by First Fleet surgeon Arthur Bowes Myers, where he refers to some of the officers giving red cloth and gold foil to the Aborigines, which they twisted into their hair. So evidence that gold foil was there. And gold foil, of course, is the thicker, when you beat gold foil down and make it paper thin, you get gold leaf. And it's gold leaf that we're seeing here. So the presence of gold certainly marks these drawings out as something to be valued. Another one, his throat and wings.
And that's a magnified image of the gold. You can see the gold underneath. This is highly magnified, this photograph, and so it looks like the watercolor is actually cracking, but you can see the gold underneath. So the second volume I'd like to look at more closely is from the Derby collection, one of those three previously unrecorded volumes compiled by Alma Burke Lambert. And it was thought at the time that we acquired it, that the State Library acquired it, we presumed it was a volume of drawings created in England rather than New South Wales. Today we refer to it as Derby Volume 4. It's a beautiful album. It features a number of striking giant birds in Lilliputian landscapes that were thought to represent English countryside and parklands, yet their park-like qualities accord with the frequent comments of the British that the land around Sydney reminded them of parks. We've met a great extent of park-like country, wrote George Worgan, an extraordinary luxuriant grass. Hunter, Philip, all describe the woods here as resembling deer parks as much as if they were intended for that purpose. The grass as fine as any park in England. And these estate-like effects are now understood to have resulted from the systematic management of the land by the local Indigenous people who regularly burned the growth and created grasslands and networks of tracks similar to what's seen in these drawings. So could these drawings have originated in New South Wales rather than England? So we started to look at the papers used and the watermarks and whether they provided some clues. So the interest here is not so much in the dating of watermarks, though that's also interesting. The evidence of watermarks can only ever be indicative of the genealogy of drawings rather than conclusive. So a watermark can give you a not before date, but they can't give you an end date for the creation of drawings. We know that Turner, for instance, the British watercolorist, used paper stock that he'd held for 40 years. So watermarks, this is all Derby Volume 4. And those black clouds in the sky are another example of the lead in the lead white paint having discolored over time. Another one. So watermarks, they're the faint manufacturer's design that you can see in paper when you hold it up to light. And they're unique to each paper mill. And the watermarks were handmade from wire and incorporated into the frame molding that holds the pulp that's used to make an individual sheet of paper. And so the watermark leaves a design mark in the finished paper. And because they're handmade, each watermark will be unique from one molding to the next, even within a single paper mill. There's all this stuff I could tell you about dating and when that became compulsory, but I'll let that slip. Otherwise, we'll be here all day. So this is a paper mill, and you can see this man here on the left, a close up, that's his paper mold. And so the paper pulp was pushed into that, and the watermark was in the wire. So exactly matching watermarks then tell us that the papers were formed not only in the same mill, but in the same paper mold. So papers across collections of drawings of New South while subjects have been found to have been created not only in the same mill but in the exact same mold, including the drawings in Derby Volume 4. Thought to have been created in England, they've now been reconsidered as possibly, even probably, created in New South Wales when compared with watermarks on drawings that it is known were created in New South Wales. So we've sort of crosswalked, as well as crosswalking the images, we've crosswalked the watermarks as well. Because paper supplies were limited in New South Wales and they were replenished then only as ships arrived, there's a strong possibility that previously unrelated watercolour drawings could in fact have been created, if not simultaneously, then within a limited time and place using the same limited stock of paper. The other thing is I can go back, the lines across these papers, these are called laid papers. And laid paper is actually paper that is made to write on, not to draw on, not to do watercolours on, because those little lines, they leave the slightest indentation in the paper and the watercolour will pool in those marks. So in England, it's unlikely to see people doing watercolour drawings on laid paper. In New South Wales, they did watercolour drawings on whatever paper they could get. So all of these things sort of ties these drawings back to New South Wales. So we've done this watermark analysis of drawings of New South Wales subjects, and it strengthened the argument that unprovenance drawings, previously dismissed as non-colonial in origin and long thought to have been created in England or even India because they were so skillful and because of the use of gold leaf, were drawn in fact in the colony, helping to establish the history and the context of the collections. And this allows then dispersed set of drawings to be pulled together that can now be sourced to New South Wales at the time of their creation, linking them together for the first time, works that had previously not been connected. And so in this small community at Sydney Cove, it becomes quite easy to imagine that drawings might have been circulated and shared, repeated, honed, refined, and copied in much the same way that stories and gossip circulated. So this rich data that we've derived from technical observation and analysis has now been added to the research based on letters and diaries, as well as auction sale records describing the dispersal of collections brought back to England from New South Wales. And so comparing the many related sets of drawings from this early colonial period has provided evidence that helps determine the history and chronology of these drawings and to understand how and where they were created, using science and observation to advance art historical information. So what became clear from the beginning of European colonization in Australia through this research was that far more people were drawing and describing what they were seeing and experiencing and recording life in New South Wales than previously thought, or that we can yet put names to. And this sort of alerts us to the precariousness of thinking we know history, that we know what happened and we have all the information. These collections raise questions we hadn't previously thought to ask and suggest possibilities we hadn't even considered. So looking at collections of drawings anew opens new patterns to understand other possible histories they engage with and even challenge some of the stories about European past in early colonial Australia. They question where our perceptions and ideas have come from, and they open up new and different sources of information, creating different perspectives on past experience. So the emergence of the Derby collection of drawings prompted new detailed art historical analysis of the traditions of botanical art production and its convention of copying and dissemination. They helped demonstrate that the colonisation of Australia was not just physical and cultural occupation of the land, but intellectual engagement with it. Their evidence of a culturally richer, more expressive colonial community than commonly thought, their evidence of a healthy engagement for many with unfamiliar and challenging surroundings. They exist in part as a tribute to our incessant inquisitiveness about what lies outside our reach, what's beyond our current knowledge and comprehension, and the compulsion to try, often not so well, to make sense of it. They signal the enduring nature of human vitality and curiosity and of the need to push boundaries and explore to try and understand the world and our place in it. So collections such as these have the capacity to shake up and challenge the stories we tell about the foundations of British colonisation in Australia. They're a powerful reminder of how our collections both reflect and inform, but can also obscure our understanding of history and ourselves. They're direct evidence that in late 18th century New South Wales, more people than we can possibly yet identify and name found ways to rise above the isolation, despair, and hardship of a remote penal colony and retain a sense of connectedness with each other and with home. And importantly, they laid the foundation for ways of responding to the land as awe-inspiring or alienating, as an endless resource or a precious heritage, as terra nullius, or a land that had been actively managed for millennia. And these are dichotomies that still challenge Australia today. Thank you. And I would just like to add that the XRF and the microscopy analysis were done by one of our conservators here on site who worked with me, Kate Hughes, and these watermark images are also Kate's. So Kate was a big part of this project with me. Thank you. Thank you. I hope I've left enough time for questions.
I'll just let Louise catch her breath. So a quick shout out to everybody online. My apologies about our little technical glitch, but I received a few text messages and we were onto that. So I've renamed our events branch the Rapid Response Team. So I hope everybody who's joined online today was able to see most of those slides. So thank you for that. So we do have some questions coming in. So the first one is actually quite interesting, and it's actually about your practice as an art historian. So obviously people have appreciated today the complexities of trying to identify those. Some of those differences, once you point them out, are really quite obvious. Oh, the tree is gone. But a lot of those differences are much more subtle. So when you approach a couple of bodies of work and you're trying to look at this one came first or maybe this one, do you study an album or do you have the multiple albums out at once?
Look, really, we couldn't do this sort of research without digitization. And I think possibly that's why it's taken so long to make the connections between the collections, because they're sort of scattered to the four corners. In 2011, as we were acquiring this collection, I spent 2 months in London, and the collection at the time still technically belonged to the Earl of Derby. But once the library had made the final payment for the collection, of course, it belonged to us, to the people of New South Wales, which meant that I could move it from Christie's site in Kensington. It still sort of, it was a bit bizarre, but they let me take the collection from Christie's across London to the Natural History Museum in South Kensington. So I was put into a black cab by a security guard and sent across to the Natural History Museum, where I was met by a security guard. And I was able to take the collection then into their library reading room. And they had made there's another collection I haven't mentioned by John Latham, which also links in to these sort of copies. They had the Watling collection and the Latham collection ready for me, and I brought the Derby collection. And so we could actually, for the first time since, probably since the 1840s, we were able to put these three collections, if it had ever happened before, put the three collections alongside each other. So that, in a way, was the starting point. But at that point, I actually didn't know what I was looking for or what I was seeing. And so once I came back, then I could look at, say, the Sydney Bird Painter album, which has been here and misattributed forever, and look at that more closely, and you start to build up a visual memory, I suppose, of the images, and you start to place them all together. And then one day a librarian walked over to me with some drawings, bad black and white photographs of some drawings that had some German text underneath them, and asked me if I could translate the German text for her, which I did. But I looked at the drawings and I thought, oh, I've seen those before. And they then played back into the other sets. And these black and white photographs were photographic copies of original drawings that are at the University of Göttingen in Germany. And they got there via one of George III's brothers, who had been educated in Germany because that was where his, you know, line took him. And he took those drawings back to Germany. So there were connections sort of sitting right before our eyes that, until you know what you're looking for, you don't actually see them. So a big part of it is building up a huge visual memory for what you're seeing, and all the different ways that clues come to you about where drawings might be held.
We have a couple of people thanking you very much for giving us the longer version of the talk. Someone has asked for part two of the talk. But we've got time for one more question. Somebody's asking if you could comment a little bit about that gold leaf expertise and how that might have been acquired in New South Wales, whether people brought it with them and shared that knowledge.
I would say certainly someone or more than one people have brought it with them, without a shadow of a doubt. The Sydney bird painter artist, that the one I showed you the multiple images with the gold, he or she is a very, very, these are the most beautiful drawings. They are such a competent artist. And on a couple of the drawings, they have actually written some explanation and given us a date, a month and a year, 1792. They are so skillfully done and by such a skillful, the gold is so skillfully done and that drawings are so skillful, they must have brought that knowledge with them. And we see gold also in some of Raper's drawings. We see some silver, not so skillfully done, but still well done. My theory is almost like a little, I don't know, I think I said in the talks, little de facto drawing schools where people who were highly skilled and people who were less skilled but very interested, like George Raper was very skilled, but not like he wasn't in Sydney bird painters category. But Raper had such an interest in drawing and he brought his own whole kit of artwork, art supplies with him. He was intensely interested. I can well imagine that he would have relished being in close proximity to someone like Sydney Bird Painter, who was so skilled and been very keen to learn. I'm not sure how keen Watling was to share what he knew, because Watling was such an embittered character and had such a high sense of his own talent and worth. But we did, talking about part two, we did turn up something very interesting about Watling too, because the most we know about Watling, apart from his drawings, is a series of letters that he wrote home to his unmarried aunt who had raised him. He was orphaned as a boy, and he wrote these wonderful letters home, which we have always interpreted as being, you know, one of the first beautiful romantic, in that romantic vein, description of New South Wales. And I was reading them one day for the, I don't know, 10th time or something, and puzzling over them, because his language is so extraordinary. It's so erudite. And it just didn't make sense where he learnt to write like that. I mean, I didn't doubt it, but I just needed to understand how he got that level of education. And so I'm sort of doodling around on Google, going down, you know, rabbit holes, coming back out again with nothing. And I did this search one day and this result came back from America. And I thought, oh, why would the US be interested in a British Australian convict artist? So I started digging around in it, and it was actually a book published in 1782, I think, certainly 84, certainly before the first fleet sailed. Certainly before any European had colonized Australia. And I started flicking through it online and I started finding Watling's exact phraseology, his exact romantic descriptions. And without a doubt, Watling had also had access to this book, either in the colony or before he left, I would say in the colony. And he has lifted this British soldiers' romantic descriptions of America and transposed them to New South Wales. So the copying went all ways and all across different media. It's absolutely fascinating to uncover all these connections, even if you can't actually explain how they all came about. So for 200 years, we've been going, oh my God, Watling is so romantic. The most romantic descriptions of New South Wales we've ever read, they weren't his. So it's amazing. It never ends, this sort of research.
Thank you so much. Unfortunately, that is all we have time for today, but fascinating insights, beautiful birds, and men who are fond of exclamation marks. What better way to start Scholar Talks for 2021? Do come back next time, the 2nd of March. Our 2020 David Scott Mitchell Fellow, Dr. Jared Hall, will be here, and he's going to share some of his environmental history expertise, and he's going to look specifically at what he calls the landscaping of Eastern Australia through colonial surveys and some of those tensions of how people saw the environment in the early colonial period. Do come back and stay safe until then. Thanks very much.